Good evening, everyone. Again, this is about mechanical ventilation basics. Mechanical ventilation is a very broad subject, and to explain it, it needs a very long course, very long times. So this is just a trial to present the basics of mechanical ventilation. It's not meant to be an exhaustive source for learning. So let's start to save your time. Starting with the level of respiratory support you provide in the PICU, as we mentioned before, you start with the low-flow oxygen therapy, like mask and nasal cannula, then high-flow nasal cannula, then non-invasive therapies, then invasive, and we will learn till the level of the conventional mechanical ventilation. High-frequency and the ECMO are beyond the scope of this course. First, let's start with a simple question about how much oxygen flow you can give in the ward. Let me phrase it in another way. If you have a patient with bronchiolitis, he has severe stress, and you put him on the nasal cannula, 3 liters per minute, but his saturation is not picking up. It's 86 or 87. Can I go more, like for 10 on the nasal cannula or 20 on the nasal cannula? Any questions you can put in the chat? To answer this question, I can't read the chat. I don't know why, but
It's okay. So you can press on the chat button. You can press it and it will show. But anyway, the answers are here. Someone said no, you cannot go higher. Someone said 6, 5, 3, 10, 5, up to 6. So these are the answers we have. No more than 2.
Yeah. Okay. If you increased the level of the oxygen flow on the wall mounted flumeter, the ordinary one, these flumeters can't humidify the air above certain level. And of course, it can't warm the air. So if you're providing this high flow via a nasal cannula, which is dry and cold, it will cause the necrosis of the respiratory epithelium and harm the patient more. So this is the idea behind this machine you can see beside this patient. It's our machine. It's a very famous machine to provide what's called humidified high flow nasal cannula serum. It's called ERVO and is the most commonly used one. Some places call it the OptiFlow. The idea behind the technology of this machine is to give very high level of the oxygen flow above the peak in inspiratory flow, but with adequate humidity and adequate temperature. When you it's the first step of the respiratory support in the ICU. If you have a patient like bronchiolitis, which is a typical patient needing a high flow nasal cannula patient, and he is not comfortable with the oxygen therapy via a mask or nasal cannula, you can use this one. You have two parameters to adjust. The FiO2, which is the concentration of the inspired oxygen, and the flow. FiO2 is managing the hypoxia. It increases the oxygen concentration in the blood, so rising the saturation. The flow is to treat the effort. Your patient may be adequately saturated, 94, 95, but he is in stress. He's tachypneic and has retractions. So to treat the effort, you treat it with flow. Regarding FiO2, you're starting with 50% and adjust according to the patient need. You can increase above to 60, but usually if the patient needing more than 50% FiO2, you need to upgrade your support to another device. And you can win if the saturation is okay. Your target saturation is not 100. 100 is very harmful to the patient, and it will need many, cause many harmful effects of the patient. So your target here is only 92%. Except in special situation, you don't need much more than 92%. Now, after adjusting the FiO2 according to the patient oxygen saturation, you then need to adjust the flow. Flow is by liter per kg per minute. If the patient is below 12 kg, you can give 2 liters per kg per minute. If above 12 kg, you can give 24 liters per kg per minute with adding 0.5 liters per kg per minute for each kilogram above the 12. And the maximum is 50. Some authors recommend only 40, but usually we don't reach these high levels of flow in the pediatric practice. You start at 6 and increase gradually to the target over a few minutes. First sign of improvement in the patient after the increase of the oxygen saturation is improvement of the tachycardia, then followed by the effort. After starting the high flow of the cannula, you don't need to wait too much to wait for effort to improve, just only 2 hours. After 2 hours, if there is no improvement of the patient effort, or you are needing a high level of support, like if I told more than 60%, please upgrade your support. Now, coming to the next level of support, which is higher than the high flow cannula, which is the CPAP. CPAP, we are familiar to use in the neonatal ICU, but it can be used in the pediatric with very good result. This is a very famous picture of the CPAP we can see in the NICU. Many of us had NICU rounds. But it's the same technology and the same machine we can use in the pediatric. Usually, we don't use CPAP above 10 kg, above 1 year. But it can be used sometimes. But usually, if you need higher support for patient more than 1 year, you have to move to CPAP, which I will explain later. CPAP is one fixed pressure above the atmospheric pressure, continuously delivering the air under pressure to the patient lung. It helps to stent the airway open. It will be open more alveoli, open the atelectasis, increase the surface area of gas exchange, improving oxygenation and ventilation. And at the end, we reduce the work of the breathing. What setting you need to adjust the CPAP? You need to give the pressure instead of the flow in the high flow cannula, but the FiO2 is a fixed parameter. Pressure usually set at 5 to 6 millimeter mercury, and FiO2 start at 50% and decrease gradually to less than 40 if possible, guided by your oxygen saturation of the patient. If you need more than 60% to achieve a good saturation, or the patient still severely stressed, you can accept mild tachypnea on CPAP, but you can't accept retractions or grunting. CPAP, if the patient has no improvement within 2 hours, you have to shift for higher support. Now coming for the mechanical ventilation, which is the actual ventilation and the idea behind it. If you are new to the BICU, you might be scared of the ventilator. At the beginning, you don't need to know the actual connections and knobs of the ventilator. First, just think the ventilator like a box, just a press, not more. If you are spending much more time in the ICU, you need to know exactly the structure. So, because our course is for beginners, we will not discuss this here. We will go for the adjusting the ventilator. What is the difference between the CPAP and the ventilation? CPAP is giving one fixed pressure all over the respiratory cycle, while the patient is breathing with his own effort on this. While in the ventilation, using PIPAP or invasive mechanical ventilation, the machine gives extra pressure during the inspiratory phase to higher pressure, which is called IBAP, inspiratory peak airway pressure, or which is called simply BIP, peak inspiratory pressure. Then return back to the level of the expiratory positive airway pressure, or simply called PEEP, positive end expiratory pressure. The difference between these two pressures will drive the air directly by the force of the machine, not the patient effort inside his own chest. So we have EBAP, which is called BEEP. We have IBAP, which is called PIB. This difference between them is called the delta B, or pressure support sometimes. Now, the rate you are delivering this pressure to the patient is the respiratory rate, and the H volume delivered with each rate is called the tidal volume. This is all the main factors affecting the regulatory cycle of the patient. Why you use BEEP? Why don't you go for only the airway pressure, the atmospheric pressure? We can use this patient, not this patient, sorry, this child trying to inflate this balloon. This balloon like the alveoli. If you see the first 2 to 3 pictures, you can see from his face, there is marked effort to open it. If you are inflating the alveoli, then leaving it to collapse totally again, it will stick to each other and will need much effort during every breath to expand it. So keeping a minimal volume of air under pressure will keep the alveoli more open. Now the ventilation can be given both invasive or non-invasive. Invasive ventilation, like we see using endotracheal tube or tracheostomy in some patient connected to the machine, while non-invasive using a tightly fitted face mask or nasal-oral mask giving an invasive ventilation. What is the cons and the pros of the H modality? Non-invasive ventilation needs much less sedation.
Dr. Atiyah, we don't hear you anymore. Maybe you hit the unmute by mistake. Are you there?
Hi.
Okay. We don't hear you anymore. You hear me? If everyone can hear me, Dr. Okay, we'll just fix this.
Oh,
I can hear you, Dr. Ahmadi.
Oh, sorry for losing.
You can start. We can hear you now.
Okay. Well, because the curfew causing pressure on the internet while the people are in their homes. Now the invasive ventilation is more efficient all the way in the air in the trachea.
We can start there again, actually, Dr. Atiyah. We lost your presentation.
Eh?
You can what? Start your presentation again. We don't see it.
Okay. Can you see it now?
Yes, we can see it. You can go ahead.
Okay. Invasive ventilation will be more efficient. All the air will be in the trachea, but you will need deep sedation of the patient. You using the intracal tube will injure the airway. So it has also its side effect, but sometimes it's the only solution you have. This is a form of non-invasive ventilation. To the left, you can see the whole face mask. To the right, you can see the nasal mask to provide the BiPAP. BiPAP usually refers to the non-invasive ventilation. I know some, especially drugger ventilators, use this name of the mode to describe the pressure control SIMV. But traditionally using the term BiPAP refers to non-invasive ventilation. It provides a suppressed rate with 2 levels of pressures and can be used for any age, even adult. Setting you use is you start with BIB with 12 to 16 millimeter mercury, BEEP 6 to 8, and rate like the patient physiological rate. If you are like patient with 2 years, he is tachypneic at 70, but his physiological rate is 30. So you fit the rate to 30, not to his tachypneic rate, to his physiological rate 30. FiO2 is the golden number for non-invasive support, all are 50% and wean gradually. In BiPAP, you can accept slightly high FiO2 for 60%, but it's not accepted to keep it very long time. It's a sign of failure. to need more than 60% of a fiber. Fiber, you can wait more time to achieve its goal, like 2 to 4 hours. And if not achieving your goals, you have to go directly for intubation and mechanical ventilation. There are signs of failure of non-invasive ventilation. If seen, don't wait for your window 2 hours or 4 hours to end. Like if the patient is already increasing work of breathing, don't wait to improve. If you are needing FiO2 more than 50%, if you are facing marked tachycardia not explained by other fever, other factor like the fever, if there is signs of fatigue or worsening of blood gas. Also, you don't use the non-invasive respiratory support from the start if you have hemodynamic instability, have to go directly for intubation. If you have depressed conscious level, it's a necessary thing in non-invasive ventilation. The patient can protect his own airway. If he can, like depressed conscious level, you can use non-invasive ventilation. There is some debate that COVID-19 patient get benefit of intubation early, but it's something controversy, and some say this will decrease the spread of infection, but actually there is no solid evidence of this. So it's like a policy linked to each place. This is invasive mechanical ventilation using a electrical tube connected to the machine. What are the indications of invasive mechanical ventilation? Invasive mechanical ventilation used in either oxygenation problem, ventilation problem, or non-respiratory indication. First, indicate oxygenation problem. Like we face a severe pneumonia, severe bronchopneumonia, it's a patient. If you need more than 60% oxygen to achieve your target saturation, or the work of breathing in spite of non-invasive ventilation, or if non-invasive ventilation is contraindicated, you have go directly for intubation and mechanical ventilation. Second arm of the vascular system is the ventilation. If you have PaCO2 higher than 8.5 to 10 kilopascal, equals to 60 to 75 millimeter mercury, with pH less than 7.25 to less than 7.2, or you have apnea, we have to go for invasive mechanical ventilation. There is some non-respiratory indication for mechanical ventilation, like the shock. Patients with advanced shock needing a high dose inotropes, you will have to intubate and ventilate, even he is well saturated. So either here is to decrease the systemic and the myocardial oxygen consumption by relieving the metabolic need of the respiratory muscles. And there is a quote which is very famous in the adult ICU, but we can use here, that the most underappreciated inotropes in ICU is the mechanical ventilation. Yes, you can use mechanical ventilation as inotropes. Also, if you are facing a patient with coma, with Gras coma scale below 8, the patient is very risky to be aspirate his own secretions and compromise his own airway. So we have to use intercal intubation and ventilation for protection of his own airway. Of course, we will need here much less parameters, but the idea is you have to intubate. Also, in severe cases of increased intercal pressure, you can use mechanical ventilation to decrease the intracranial pressure. Of course, the post-arrest patient, you keep him ventilated and intubated till return of the conscious level and hemodynamics. Also, some surgical operations need both operative mechanical ventilation, like cardiac surgeries and airway reconstruction. Now, if you decided to intubate your patient and ventilate him, what is the initial ventilatory setting for invasive ventilation? First, the mode. The mode is which way the ventilator interact with the patient. To explain the different types of mode will be time-consuming for you, but for beginners, you would say our unit is strategy to use pressure controlled SIMV, you just adjust it in the machine, leave it, then going for adjusting your FiO2. You start with very high FiO2, actually 60 to 100%, but it's just for a few minutes. Why you use one of this? Because intubation will give the patient a relative period of hypoxia. during intubation. So rapidly decrease from 100 to less than 60%, if possible, guided by your oxygen. You start your BIB with 16 to 20 millimeter mercury, guided by auscultation and chest wall movement. If chest wall is markedly raised, decrease the BIB. Your BIB starting with 5 to 6 and rate the physiological rate of the patient. Then the inspirator time, it's 0.4 to 0.5 seconds in infant and 0.6 to 0.8 seconds in adult. After initiation of the ventilation, stabilization of the patient, you repeat your blood gas frequently, usually 1 to 2 hours after initiation, and every change of your patient parameters. Then according to the saturation and the blood gas, you can choose to change your setting. First, to improve oxygenation, you can use increase FiO2. Then if you reach 60%, then increase the BIP. We increase FiO2 in steps of 5 to 10 in each step, and increase the BIP 1 by 1 in each step. And vice versa, the patient is very high saturation, 199, decrease the FiO2, then decrease the BIP. If CO2 is high, you can increase CO2 elimination by increasing the rate or increasing the tidal volume by increasing the BIB. When you increase the BIB, will be much more difference between the BIB and the BIP, will providing much more volume to achieve your CO2 elimination. Don't forget that you are treating the patient. You are not managing the machine only. So non-ventilatory actions are as important as ventilatory actions, like suctioning of the airway, bronchodilator therapy, cautious fluid management, like ARDS, you can keep him on the next side. Fluid management, hemodynamic support, don't forget to manage. Now we will start with few case discussions to apply what we have just mentioned.
Dr. Atiyah, can you see the chat or do you want me to read for you for the answers?
If you please can read it, Dr. Ahmed.
Okay, no problem.
Here we have 8 months old boy, his X-ray on the right, at this X-ray at admission to the general ward, not to the BIC. He had 3 days on the ward, then deteriorated. He is going to be ICU. His initial diagnosis was he has RSV bronchitis. He tried CPAP, but failed. So we intubated him and ventilated with the following setting: FiO2 50%, BIB 17, B5, and the rate is 35. Now blood gas showing the following: his pH is 7.21. BCO2 9.1 kilopascal, 68 millimeter mercury. I used both units because we have mixed audience from Kuwait and Egypt. So some use here, some use this. So CO2 is 9.1 kilopascal, 68 millimeter mercury. My carb is 22 and saturation is 98%. What do you suggest for this patient to change? Or you just want to keep him? This?
So we have the answers. Most of them are increasing the rate and increasing the PIP to wash out the CO2.
Yes, exactly. The problem here, we have acute respiratory acidosis. The problem is CO2 retention, so you can treat by either increasing the rate or increasing the PIP. Yes, you are totally right. Very bad X-ray, actually. This 2-year-old boy presented to BICU with severe proctopneumonia. We tried hyaluronidase cannula, unfortunately, failed. Now he was intubated and ventilated with the following parameters. His FiO2 is 40%, his BIB is 20, his BIB is 6, and we need a high rate to achieve normal CO2, 35. Now his blood gas is pH 7.34, CO2 6.1, bicarb is 22, and saturation is 88. Do you suggest any change here for this patient?
So we have some answers about increasing PIP, increasing FiO2, increasing the PEEP. Most of them are saying increase the PEEP and the FiO2, but we have some of them saying about increasing the PIP.
Yes. Here the problem is low oxygen saturation, so can be treated by increasing FiO2. Here FiO2 is 40%, so there is a safe window to increase. So you can start with FiO2. If you reach 60 or 50% with no improvement, you can increase the PEEP later. Actually, if you increase the BRB, some of our colleagues say this. Actually, increase the BRB will increase the saturation, you know, but it's not the ideal solution.
So, Dr. Atiyah, can you say why increasing the BIP will also help?
BIP will help because increasing the BIP will increase what's called mean airway pressure. The whole average pressure all over the battle cycle will increasing. Increasing is the drive, the drive of the oxygen in the blood. So it will help. But it will help the number. But actually, it's not the ideal way. Not actually the ideal way. You can use it in extreme condition. Like you have very high BIP and the high FiO2, so you can increase the BIP later. But in this patient, we have FiO2 is 40 and the BIP is 6, not very high parameter. So you can increase them instead of BIP.
Excellent, thank you.
Here, also very bad X-ray. This is 4 years old. Girl in BICU with meningococcemia causing septic shock. She needs a high dose of anitrox infusion, so we ventilated here. Second day of admission to BICU, she developed also multiple organs function syndrome, and one of this spectrum of the syndrome is the one causing ARDS. She needed higher BIP and higher FiO2 and higher rate also. Her FiO2 now is 55%, BIP is 22%. BIP is 8, rate is 35. Hair blood gas, sorry, it's a typo here. Hair blood gas 2 hours after initiation and the modification of this last setting are pH 7.28. BCO2 is high, case is 3 millimeter mercury, 8.4 kilopascal. Bicarb is 20 and saturation is 94. What are your suggestions here for this patient?
So people already started answering. One of them said the high frequency ventilation, and some said to go for increasing the rate, increasing the PIP. Most of the answers are rate and PIP. One of the answers is few answers are high frequency, and most of them are saying increasing the PIP. So you, Dr. Atiyah, you can shock them with the answer.
Yes, it's not very shocking. Here, first identification of the problem says that we have hypercapnia. Yes, we have hypercapnia. But this ARDS patient needs what we call lung protective strategy. Lung protective strategy is that patient with this may the ventilation harm them. You don't need to harm them with the ventilation to treat the disease, then you are facing the complication of the ventilation. So lung protective strategy consists of three main arms. First is idealization of the BIP. Second is using low tidal volume, 6 millimeters. And the third is very important, is the permissive hypercapnia. Here, although CO2 is high, 63, but we consider it's not a problem. You can accept hypercapnia in ARDS patient, provided that pH is higher than 7.2, and some authors recommend even 7.15. So this patient, although he has rotary acidosis, but this patient, I will accept this parameter, I will not increase them. So it's called, strategy called permissive hypercapnia. You can accept pH up to 10, which is like 70 to 80 millimeter mercury, and pH down to 7.2 can be accepted in ARDS patient. Some colleagues consider this high frequency. This patient is not yet indicated, but if he still deteriorating like this, he might need it in the future. But at this point, we will not need not to change the ventilator and don't change the parameters. Case number 4. This is unlucky boy. He is 6 years old boy, admitted to be ICU with viral myocarditis. He has very poor myocardial performance. Transthoracic echo saying that his ejection fraction is about or even less than 20%. He needs a Marinone infusion. During his stay, he developed frosty secretion, severe dyspnea, severe orthopnea, and saturation, a picture suggestive of pulmonary edema. We intubated him with FiO2 60% needed, BIP 22, BIP 7, and rate is 25. His saturation is 88%. His pH is 7.36, CO2 is 6.1, which is slightly high, but can be accepted in normal venous blood gas, and the bicarb is 21. What are your suggestions here? What is the problem and what is the treatment?
Okay, we see some of them said high frequency ventilation, increase the PEEP, increase the FiO2, and Dr. Fatma Al-Haddad says LASIX, and Dr. Yes. Abdulaziz LASIX. Some of them said LASIX as well.
Yes, exactly. Dr. Fatma and Dr. Aziz are very excellent. Here, we learn not to forget the non-ventilatory management of the original disease. Of course, at the acute setting of this patient, you can increase the FiO2 and decrease the PEEP exactly just to provide the cold saturation. But the main therapy here is to increase the diuretics and the inotrope dose of the patient. If you don't use diuretic and put your patient on negative side balance and use maximization of inotropes, you will never be able to win this patient from the patient. Case number 5, and it's not the last, the one before the last. Here is 11 months old boy with a history of uncorrected VECD on anti-failure medication. He is using LASIX, digoxin, and aldactone. Here we can see the cardiomegaly and the lung congestion. He left uncorrected, unfortunately, because he has repeated chest infections, preventing him from going to the operating theater many times. He had severe bronchopneumonia this time, and this time was severe enough to need BICU admission. We failed to treat him with CPAP, and he was mechanically ventilated. Now settings are FiO2 40%, PIB is 18, PEEP is 5, and rate is 30. His oxygen saturation is 98%, and his blood gas showing pH is 7.38, CO2 6.2, and the bicarb is 21. What are your suggestions here?
So we can see here saying withdraw settings, decrease the rate, extubate, and compensated treatment infection.
Yes. Maybe patient is ready for extubation, but time being, the needed action, which is actually an emergency action to decrease the FiO2, targeting lower saturation. His saturation is 98%. In any patient, 98% may be good but harmful due to release of oxidative material and something. But here would be very dangerous. IFIO2 is a pulmonary vasodilator. Patient has VECD. All left to right shunt, if you decreased the causing the oxygen to be high, causing vasodilation of the pulmonary vessels, will cause flooding of the lung with fluid. So this patient, while stable now, few hours later, he will need very high setting due to lung flooding and increase pulmonary water content. So here it's emergency, like if the patient is 88%, it's emergency to be 98%. So here we have to decrease rapidly the FiO2 to keep his saturation below 94. But don't forget to be not going for the 80s. Just below 90 to 94 is good for this patient. Here is our last case. He is 6 years old boy with massive intracranial hemorrhage secondary to head trauma. He had rapidly deteriorating conscious level. His Gradscoma scale became 6. So we rapidly intubated him waiting neurosurgical intervention. Now his setting are FiO2 30%. As we expect in normal lung, we will not need much high setting. If I do 30%, BIB is 18, PEEP is 5, and rate is 20. His blood gas is pH 7.48, CO2 is 29 millimeter mercury, which is 3.9 kilopascal, bicarb is 21, and saturation is good, 96%. What are your suggestions for this patient?
So most of them are saying nothing, hyperventilate, keep the same, and nothing. Some say they decrease the rate. Most of them are saying no changes.
Here, the needed action is also emergency action. You have to decrease the rate because low CO2 will be associated with decreased blood flow to the cerebral circulation, compromising the brain blood supply, causing more brain hypoxia. So the neuroprotection measures include normocapnia, not hyper, not hypo, But hypocapnia can be used as transient maneuver in case of brain herniation. Here, the patient has no signs of brain herniation, not mentioned here, so we suppose that there is none. So your target here is not hypocapnia, it's the normal capnia. It's emergency action to correct the SGO2 to be in the normal level. I finished the cases. Just the high frequency of ventilation, we will not explain too much about it. Just need to know where to use this. If you need it, high to more than 60% and to be higher than 10 to maintain target saturation, or the mean airway pressure, the all over average airway during the rotary cycle calculated by the machine is higher than 16 to maintain target saturation and CO2, you have to switch your patient for high frequency ventilation. Thank you for this lecture, listening, and remember that the machine has no brain. Please use your own one. Thank you.